Sharada, please start the program.
ओम गजाननम भूत गणाति सेवितम कपित्त जंबू फलसार भक्षितम उमासुतम शोक विनाश कारणम नमामि विघ्नेश्वर पाद पंकजम शारदा शारदाम्बोज वदनावदनाम्बुजे सर्वदा सर्वदा अस्माकं सन्निधिं सन्निधिं क्रियात् वाग्देव्यै नमः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेद विभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं सदाशिवसमारम्भां व्यासशङ्करमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्परां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानामालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशङ्करं लोकशङ्करम् ॐ श्रीविद्यातीर्थजगद्गुरवे नमः भारतीकरुणापात्रं भारतीपदभूषणं भारतीपदमारूढं भारतीतीर्थमाश्रिये विद्याविनयसम्पन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वन्दे वेदान्ततत्त्वज्ञं विदुशेखरभारतीं सद्गुरुचरणारविन्दाभ्यां नमः श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः Humbly feel blessed to extend this hearty welcome to you all on this auspicious Ganesh Chaturthi day. On behalf of Tattvaloka and Sringeri Guru Bandavas, has been a fantastic Chaturmasyam, very divine, very blessed, with so many events happening week after week, day after day with the Parayanams. And all with the blessings of our Ubhay Jagat Gurus. Our namaskarams to the Ubhay Gurus. Taking you back to last Saturday when we had the Narayaniyam, Sriman Narayaniyam Parayanam, it was an overwhelming response. We thought that we would have perhaps 1,000 people, but ended up having over 6,000 participants. So as the Parayanam was progressing, as the, you know, sort of moving from Totaka meter to Sammata to the Rasa Krida. So the pitch of the, you know, sort of divine pitch and the moods of the participants also increased. So the eyes were vying with the ears, ears were vying with eyes to see and behold Krishna. Am I seeing the Krishna, or am I hearing the Krishna Tattvam, or am I a gopi also to get there, to handhold and hold his hands and get the mukti of Krishna? That was the emotion and the bliss of the Brahman that Bhagavan Krishna showed through Narayana Bhattadri's Narayaniyam Parayanam. Krishna is to Bhagavan Swayam. So he himself declared that he was Bhagavan. So being a Balaka and also foot by foot, he showed that, you know, he was Bhagavan and proclaimed himself one as well. So he performed this Rasa Krida, which is nothing but the utmost moksha pradhanam actually. Gobihi Shabdam says, Gobihi Muktim Labeta, sorry, Gobihi Indriyehi Bhakti Bhakti Rasam Pibati iti Gopihi. Gopi is the one with the Indriyas, drinks that Bhakti Rasa. And at the end, Krishna says that, you know, you are worthy of my blessing of moksha pradhanam. So he's the one who showed the all the purusharthas. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha, everything is given by this ultimate paramatma. And when he performed Rasa Krida, he was only 8 years old, Balaka. So he was a yogi, Yogishwara. So after finishing this feat of Rasa Krida, he goes and meets with the mother and father, Vasudeva and Vasudeva and Vasuki. And he says, I lost this 14 years. By the time he gets there, it was 14 years. I lost this 14 years to serve you, you being the, you know, parents. So I was such a duradrishta, my, you know, sort of befallen on me, but I am here to save and serve you as well. So as per the Prashnot Ratnamalika, Pratyaksha Devata Ka says, you know, asks the question and gives the answer, our Adi Shankara. He says, who is the perceptible goddess? None other than the mother. And then the perceptor to be honored is who is none other than the Father. So he himself tells us that the mother and father, Matrudevo Bhava, Pitrudevo Bhava, is part of the utmost Dharmartha, actually. And then he goes to his guru, Sandipani, for his Gurudevo, Acharya Devo Bhava. And then the last avatar of Krishna was as an Acharya, Jagadguru, in the Gita Acharya, preaching the Moksha Sadhana to Arjuna himself. So such was the greatness of Krishna. That's why we say, Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum. And we have been doing this Guru Saparya Parayanam, starting from Bhagwan Dakshinamurti, and then Krishna, and then followed by the Vyasa, Shankara, and to the, our latest gurus, or the present gurus rather. So in Prashnotatramalika, Acharya says, Kascha Bhagavan, who is the Lord? He says, Maheshaha Shankara Narayana Atmakaha. So that explains that he is both Narayana and Shankara. That's why we hold the Ishwara, Aishwarya Bhavam Ishwaraha. So Ishwara and then Krishna and then followed by Vyasa, Shankara and then our present Guru Parampara. Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum. And he was a Yogeshwara. So in our own Guru Parampara, we have our Vidyatirtha Swamiji sitting in Lambika Yoga, still present in the Lambika Yoga as Bhagavan, as Jagadguru. Such is the greatness of our Guru Parampara. And we are also blessed to be the sishyas of this Guru Parampara. Coming to today's speech, Krishna Bhagavan showed Yashoda the Vishwarupa by opening his mouth. And we have with us the speaker, Sri N. Venkatramanji. When he opened his mouth in 2018, he showed the entire Guru Parampara to us. Although we have read and heard so many things about our Guru Parampara, putting together in a compendium and presenting it as, this is the Guru Parampara of this 1200 years, starting from Adi Shankara, he had the blessing to give us that Vishwarupa of the Guru Parampara of ours. Such is the greatness of Sri N. Venkatramanji, who was handpicked by Mahasannidhanam himself to deliver this address. That was his ordain. Jagadguru Shabdam was given to Krishna and after that to Adi Shankara. That's why our Guru Parampara is also a Jagadguru Parampara. And here he is to give us the bouquet of flowers chosen by him as to who are all the people responsible and how does it make sense for us to have the right guru and is it possible to have only one guru? So we welcome Sri N. Venkatramanji today to give his speech. And it's not just a speech, it is going to be an interactive question answer session. So we have conceived of all the possible doubts or dilemma one would have to get the right guru or to find the right guru. Thank you so much. Over to you, Sri Venkatramanji.
Swami.
Thank you, sir. Maybe we will now start the questionnaire session. It is going to be an interactive session with a few devotees have sent us a question and we are going to have a detailed discussion about that. So may we request you to kindly give an initial thought over it and then we will start this program.
Shuklam Varadaram Sashivarnam Chaturbhujam Prasanna Vatanam Dhyayet Sattva Vikno Shantihe माला सुधाकुंभ विबोध मुद्रा विद्याविराज करवारी जाता अपार कारुण्य सुधाम्बुराशिं श्री शारदाम्बां प्रणतोऽस्मि नित्यम् वसुदेव सुतं देवं कंसचानूर मर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं व्यासाय विष्णुरूपाय व्यासरूपाय विष्णवे नमो वैब्रह्म नितिगे वासिष्ठाय नमो नमः शङ्कारूपेण मच्चित्तं पङ्कीकृतमभूद्यया किङ्करीयस्य सामाय शङ्कराचार्यमाश्रये प्रह्लाद वरदो देवो यो नृसिंह परोहरि नृसिंहोपासकं नित्यं तं नृसिंह गुरुं भजे श्री सच्चिदानंद शिवा अभिनव्य नृसिंह भारत्यभितान् यतीन्द्रान् विद्यानिधीं मंत्रनिधीं सदात्मनिष्ठान् भजे मानव शंभुरूपान् सदात्मज्ञानरतं विषयेभ्य परान्मुखं नौमि शास्त्रेषु निष्णातं चंद्रशेखर भारती विवेकिनं महाप्रज्ञं धैर्योदारक्षमानिधिं सदाभिनवपूर्वं तं विद्यातीर्थ गुरुं भजे अज्ञानां जाह्नवीतीर्थं विद्यातीर्थं विवेकिनां सर्वेषां सुखतं तीर्थं भारतीतीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनयसंपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांततत्त्वज्ञं विदुशेखर भारती I offer this entire discussion, interactive session, at the lotus feet of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, Mahasannidhanam and Sannidhanam. Namaste to each one of you. I would take the questions straight away rather than trying to give a brief introduction for the simple reason that the entire admin team has worked on some questions with some people. So my initial thought process and their orientation of questions I do not know whether it will match. So I would request them to start with the questions, and whatever very little I am blessed to know, both out of little bit of reading and more out of going to Sringeri for the last several decades. Let me share. This talk, I assure you, is going to be more on Guru Tattva. So any listener can possibly draw something out of it is the hope. And if that hope gets achieved, then this talk might have found its use ultimately. With these opening words, may I request the team to put forth the questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ji. It has been said in the introduction that the Saparia programs have reached many homes, thousands of homes this year. The Saparia was able to penetrate into, find a deep penetration into such a big reach it had. That is because of the technology that we are seeing. So in this sense, I would like to ask you, sir, whether what is your take on the current prevailing mindset of the present generation, generally on terms of dharma and the value system?
See, can we broadly put the whole question into two buckets so that a modern mind understands it quite easily? The first bucket, or the vertical, what are we as human beings interested in, as parents, as grandparents, as children, three generations put together? What is our objective in life we should accomplish? We should be very successful. We should be noteworthy and recognized, and we should be very happy. So the whole life is motivated and driven by accomplishment as the objective. When this forms the foundation, then one has to work only towards that. So how do we all organize ourselves in the modern life? In order to achieve that accomplishment, we use our buddhi, sharpen the intellect day in and day out. Keep exploring, keep researching, keep slogging it out, and then try to produce tangible, visible results. Show proof to the world that we are noteworthy people. See, here is the proof. And therefore, our whole life stream has been accomplishment, effort preceded by proof, and then tangible results. And using our intellect, driven strongly by what we call it as the ego. So we use only two tools invariably. We use our bodies, okay, but we use invariably our mind and intellect to produce these accomplishments. So this is one vertical. There is yet another vertical also in life where it wants all of us to understand, well, you are using your body, your mind, and the intellect to do these accomplishments. Have you ever focused yourself in trying to know what this body comprises of? What this mind is made up of? How do you tackle your intellect? Are you controlling, are you using all this to control yourself, control your senses? Are you in place? So these things are something here in this vertical. It is accomplishment, which foundation is the foundation or the desire or the driven focal point. In this vertical, it is all revelation. It is all realization. It is all intangible. And it is not based on empirical proof or data. It is based on belief or faith. And this, as we see, intellect is driven by ego there. This belief or faith is being driven by what we call it as God. So you have two strong verticals in life. Now answer yourself the question you have posed. Does the modern mind, is it prepared to focus only on the first vertical, or is it prepared to integrate also the second vertical with the first vertical? What we say, how is it relevant for me to accomplish? I need to work, I need to produce myself, I need to show to people. So you are talking of something which is intangible. It will produce result at some point of time. You're talking of something which is not available to us right now to perceive. And therefore, in my very, very humble view, I'm not making an overgeneral statement. The attitude of a modern mind is more towards accomplishments ending with human ego rather than trying to understand realization as a pursuit, having God at the helm of his life. This, I will think, portray as how a modern mind reacts.
Thank you, Ji.
Thank you.
Great, Vijay. It was a very informative. When our mind tends to question and don't want to believe, does it impact on our daily lives and routines?
Yeah, I think it's a very direct and a more impactful question, I should say. It does. It does impact us. I'll tell you how. See, when you believe only in the first vertical of accomplishments headed by ego, then you tend to lose to our Sanatana Dharma. Ultimately stands on two verticals, the karma followed by dharma. Karma in its huge umbrella, the past, present, and the future. And dharma, how you utilize your present life, present body as a human being, mind and intellect in a meaningful, useful way. So when a modern mind is tending to believe this life starts with this body and ends with body and ends with this body and does not have a faith in the first perishing casualty in the process is loss in what is called as karma. We tend to lose our faith over karmas. As a result of which, we tend to also give up dharmas. So what happens to a modern mind? Look here. Go and come and preach me. This is good. This is bad. This is moral. This is not moral. I am not prepared to listen. See that person, how he is. He is successful. He is wealthy. He is prosperous. And he gets away with everything. Please, now what is happening, modern mind, your scriptures, your Sanatana Dharma and its tenets, which should possibly form the foundation or basis for life, is displaced or substituted by people around you who are magical performers and who become the source of inspiration, the source of historical trends, and you want to follow their footprints. So karma and dharma becomes the first casualty in our daily impactful life. This in a cyclic and a continuous process, if it happens, then we tend to lose faith and belief in God. We tend to lose faith in our value systems, in our traditions, and in our culture. We tend to lose faith in our overall performance and obligations towards the society. We become more and more selfish and self-centered. And ultimately, it all boils down to, finally, if you go and ask somebody, they may say, yeah, it's all fine. After all, it's all part of our legacy for millennia. But we don't have time. And why you don't have time? Because you will, any human being will find the time, provided he or she is interested in pursuing that particular objective. So lack of time is only because of lack of interest. So how does it impact us? Loss in faith in karma, loss in faith in dharma, loss in faith in traditions and value system. In fact, respect to elders. You take any aspect in life, they say, I have the right to question. I will keep asking questions, because your material world of accomplishments is achieved only through questioning. So unless I'm convinced with an answer, I don't want to believe you. So this as a whole becomes the aspect of living in a modern way and a modern mind. It impacts. It definitely impacts.
Thank you, Anmiji.
So, I would like to ask, in the absence of faith in divine grace, what is the modern mind's perspective of Guru Tattva?
See, whether it's a question of whether they first believe in, we'll put it this way. What is their understanding of Guru? That I think I'll put it that way. Their understanding of Guru is this. According to a modern mind, if there are problems, there must be solutions. So every problem will have a solution. So somebody has to fix the solution. If you have a problem in your health, doctor has to fix it. I'm ready to compensate the doctor. If you have a problem with your boss, the problem has to be fixed. Either the boss should quit or I should quit. So likewise, when we get into problems in life, which all of us do, when we get into problems in life, we want somebody to fix it and solve it. So anybody who does a magical wonder gives you a panacea. Okay, this is solved. You do this, it will get solved. And for any reason, it gets solved. Then that person becomes actually a guru. So guru is one who solves. I will get into problems and somebody has to solve it. Then if he solves it, then he is a guru. I'm ready to accept him. Because, and next time if he doesn't solve, then he loses the credibility. He said, no, this time he didn't solve, therefore I'll change to somebody else. It's all based on your equation of how somebody is fixing your problem. This is why, because we have not been grounded into the dharmic way of understanding. Guru is not somebody who does only does a magic to you. So guru is not a problem solving person. Guru is somebody who takes care of you as an entity. as a human being nurtures you. When an occasion comes, I'll try to explain it in a much better way. So the point is, this is how they try to fix a problem and fix a solution. But understand, having asked this question, I think it's my duty to also convey what is Guru Tattva as we understand in our Sanatana Dharma. In fact, Sharda Ji was also reciting the shloka. Upanishads and shlokas, everywhere there is an authentic confirmation that Brahman, God, and Guru are one and the same. They are not different. This is the first point which we should understand. And see the sequence in which they connect it. They help us to understand it this way. All of us know this world is made up only of Brahman. Everything is an illusion. Let's not get into the Vedantic part of it today. Brahman resides in you and in me. And what does it do? This Brahman, which resides in our heart, takes the shape and form as multiple plural gods and deities for our benefit to pray. So it's the same Brahman which takes a form as deities. And likewise, it is the same Brahman which takes the form of a guru or a prasapta. And our philosophy teaches us this guru, who is nothing but verily Brahman, makes you to surrender to God, and in the process surrender to him. And when you do an absolute surrender to him, saying, I don't want anything else in this world other than your holy feet, he initiates you on what? Teaching you, caring for you, taking you forward, ultimately to say you are nothing but verily the Brahman. So it starts with Brahman. It takes two forms as deities and guru. Then guru takes you to the God and then takes you to himself and finally merges you back, saying you are nothing but Brahman. This is actually the foundation or the basis of Guru Tattva in Sanatana Dharma. Harini, I'm not able to hear you.
So, are there any categories or gradations among Guru?
Yeah, good. See, I'll put it this way. In our system, we recognize we only surrender to a guru who is a Jivan Mukta. One who is a Jivan Mukta and can make a Sishya Jivan Mukta is called a guru. But we should understand the whole bouquet of Sanatana Dharma. I want to deal this question with an answer more from the functional part. I am not here to comment upon the abilities or what the status of a guru here, because I am nobody. I am not a Jivan Mukta to find out somebody to know where he or she is. So my attempt to answering you this question is, there are gradations, at least for the purpose of worldly understanding. See, it's like a pyramid. The bottom of the pyramid has the biggest base. And the topmost of the pyramid is so thin and narrow that it can hold only a few people there. So how does the pyramid work? In India and elsewhere, when it comes to Sanatana Dharma, we have a lot of people who do work as social reformers. People who actually impact millions and millions of people. We were talking about two verticals. A human mind and intellect gets tired out of accomplishments or failure to accomplish at some point of time. And it looks back to see, is there anything else? I'm getting into your vacuum. When such people get into your vacuum, there are social reformers who connect with them and try to make them understand life doesn't start just with accomplishments and life can't go just with ego. They don't take you into serious philosophical approaches. But we should be very, very thankful because they serve as the first best connect as social reformers. Then the second tier is religious reformers. People who impart religious practices amongst human beings. So much of prayers are happening. So much of events are happening. So much of parayanams are happening. After all, you have seen it in Guru Saparya. You have done Durga Parameshwari Stotram chanting. So there are people who integrate and serve this cause of Sanatana Dharma in a religious way. That's the second tier. Then you go to the third tier, spiritual, where people as teachers explain you Sanatana Dharma is not just rituals or karmas. Sanatana Dharma has Upanishads as at its helm, teaching you how to unravel yourself and become Brahman. So they teach, and they are the most worthy people of respect. All of us should shower our respect to such people, because it is they who stand up for Sanatana Dharma and propagate to the world. Our religion is not just rituals or karmas. Now, the last or the top of the pyramid are those who are Jivan Muktas, who we call it in our Dharma as Gurus. Jivan Muktas, who can make a Sishya or a disciple as a Jivan Mukta. So the bottom of the pyramid starts with social reforming, and the top of the pyramid ends with Jivan Muktas. These are the types of people who serve Sanatana Dharma.
Thank you, Ji.
Thank you.
In that case, Ji, are there any categories or gradations among Shishyas as well?
Oh, yeah. See, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam has said this. I will quote that and try to also interpret it to the best of my ability. Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam has said, people who come here, the Shishyas, broadly fall into four categories. Broadly, those Shishyas who are blessed with a wonderful life, they come there, explain how wonderful life is to them, and Acharya expresses happiness and conveys their blessings. That's one category. The second category, people who have not been so fortunate in the material world and who undergo a lot of pain and suffering. And when they come, Acharya says, every time when somebody conveys their pain, they undergo that pain themselves. And with deep devotion, they say, on behalf of that Shishya, we pray to Mata Sharada and Chandra Moheshwara. That's the second category of Shishya. The third, people who come there only for emancipation and progression. They say, enough is enough for us in the material world. Can you guide us into the path of self-realization? They fall into the third category. And there is also the fourth category. People who come to judge, to experiment, to question, to ridicule, I mean, whatever you may say. When they come and go, they also come. So they're part of the darshan. Acharya says, It's like a worm which moves on our hands. The moment they move, we take the worm and then put it back. They are of no consequence to us. And Acharya also says, of the four, the Shishya whom we admire is the one falling under the third category. People who come and pray, can you guide us towards self-realization? So these are the four broad categories of Shishyas. But we must also know a few things. See, as Shishyas, we have some responsibilities. We must make one sankalpa to ourselves. When it comes to Guru Tattva, we are nobody to judge, nobody to comment, and nobody to pass views on any other disciple or Shishyas. We have no business, because Guru-Shishya relationship is extremely interpersonal. We can help somebody till they acclimatize themselves. When somebody reaches the stage where the Guru and Shishya is able to interact within themselves, then I think even as parents, we should move away. Once that fruition happens, we should move away, because it is so interpersonal. Only Acharya, only a Guru knows what his karmas are, what his prarabdha are, and what sort of a guidance he is entitled to. So we can't be adding value or subtracting anything out of it. So Guru-Shishya relationship is very, very interpersonal and very, very private. This is something which every Shishya should hold close to his heart. And whatever Guru tells you, keep it to yourself. There may be very intricate things which are very, very sukshma, only entitled for your consumption and practice. Don't be discussing it with everybody. So these are the types of Shishyas possibly I have come across in my very limited experience.
Jay, could you please also tell us what are the qualities attributable to a guru?
I think I don't have to say it. I'll repeat it. Whatever our acharyas have said. I think this is one question where I don't have to be modern. I don't have to meet with any modern minds of a modern, meet the requirements of a modern mind. We should be quite classical when it comes to this question. What are the qualities of a guru? An indispensable call. Somebody can be called a guru only if he is a Jivan Mukta, he is a realized soul. One, who is a master of all scriptures. There is nothing he does not know about realization. And three, one who practices the scriptures. And four, one who is capable of emancipating a Shishya as himself. Making a Shishya himself as a guru, by making him realize Brahman. This is the prime quality as per Sanatana Dharma of a guru. There are other qualities which is also being stated. See, who is a guru? Somebody who is selfless. Somebody who is egoless. Somebody who has given up everything and ready to work for the Shishya. One who is neither selfless nor egoless. One who is sinless. One who is desireless. One who is flawless. Selfless, desireless, flawless, egoless. Have you ever heard any of our gurus saying, please do this for me because I like it? in your interaction. So these are the attributes which a guru should possess, he says. And the third important aspect is, third component is, a guru should be an ocean of compassion. What do you mean by ocean of compassion? We have heard of compassion, but what do you mean by ocean of compassion? A guru, a quality of a guru, as Mahasamidhanam has said very many times. What is the quality of a guru? A guru doesn't think, because a guru is always in contemplation, as he even talks with all of us. And if he chooses to think about something, Acharya says, a guru is one who can think one and only about the welfare of a shishya. If at all he thinks, a guru should think only about the welfare of a shishya, only then he is a guru. And what type of a welfare concern he should show? A guru is one who will do this service, this guidance to a shishya without expecting anything in return. No agenda. A guru doesn't become a strategic partner in your life. A guru is somebody who can shower overflowing love and compassion to you and expect nothing from you. That's a guru. Have you ever heard? You go and tell, this has happened to me. I'm so happy. Oh, fine. Blessings. This has happened to you. Okay. Where is my quid pro quo? Have you ever heard it in your life? In 1200 days of the history? So, when a guru serves the interest of a shishya, he does it without an agenda and without any expectation. All these qualities put together make someone a guru.
Very crystal clear, ji. Thank you very much for the explanation.
Thank you, Nikhil.
To attain and be worthy of such a guru, what is expected of a true shishya and his attributes and more?
In fact, a shishya doesn't have so many conditions to fulfill, even though there are some criteria he should still meet with. What is expected of a shishya is unflinching devotion and loyalty to the guru. That is something which a guru is entitled to find out from you. Are you devoted to him? Yes, let's try it, yeah. Let's see whether he is able to help us. Guru will say, well, all right, I don't have to help you. Can easily say that and wash off his hands. You will get guru's guidance and support only if you are devoted. That's one criteria. A shishya has to also be very humble. In our today life, our vertical, what does it say? Accomplishment headed by ego. So if you carry that ego and go to a guru, apply your ego in every minute of your conversation or time with your guru, you will get no help from the guru. Why should he help you? From you're using your ego. Go to people who are equally egoistic and go and find your problems, fix your problems. So, humility and a mind to surrender to the guru is the second quality of a shishya. Three, very important. A guru will guide only such shishya who will carry out his commands. A divine guidance should never go waste. Therefore, It's not that you come here, I'll give you a solution. That's not how a guru operates. That's not how a guru functions. You have to be humble, you have to be devoted. Beyond that, in case you get a guidance, are you a worthy Shishya who is ready to follow, practice, and carry the guidance to its logical end? And unless you bring that into fruition, you will not be given the next lesson. It is not like completing a syllabus. Guru Shishya is not course for 3 years, crash course in 15 days, then get something. You don't get any such thing with the guru. That's not Guru Shishya relationship. It's a lifelong relationship. Unless you have perfected something which he has guided you first, and in a flawless way, guru is not going to impart the next lesson, whatever time it takes, it takes. And important fifth quality is, a Shishya should never feel jealous about a co-Shishya. That's paramount for one. It's a paramount requisite for a Shishya. Because each Shishya has his own path. See, a guru is common. His love, his compassion flows equally to everyone. See, the mother's love and guru's love are one and the same. Only thing is, mother's love is bonded. Guru's love is detached. Can a mother love one child better than the other child? Have you ever heard it? So, a guru can also shower only love and overwhelming love. Therefore, but one Shishya may be more competent to take lessons quickly, guidance quickly and progress, while somebody else can be slow. For which guru knows how to take care of that deficiencies. You are not supposed to feel jealous. And above all, a Shishya is one ready to serve the guru what the guru wants you to serve. You can't choose, I will serve the guru the way I want. No way. Guru says, thanks a lot, I don't want your service. He has, because he only knows. Because why? When serving the guru does not benefit the guru. Serving the guru is only to benefit you. And only a guru knows what type of a service will benefit you. So the right is always with the guru, not with the Shishya. You should go and say, I'm ready to serve. And remember, when it comes to guru, you can't trust yourself into service. It's not possible. Serving a guru, one must be only blessings can take you. Divine grace can take you to a guru to serve. Serving a guru is not easy. It's not like you can pick and choose. If you are mindless, if you are reckless, if you are casual, if you are temperamental, if you are egoistic, guru will say, I don't want your service. You can handle it ourselves. So serving the guru is one of the lakshanas of a Shishya. And Mahasannidhanam concludes after narrating the qualities of a guru and Shishya and says, it's like dharma and adharma. Adharma will never become dharma. And dharma will never become adharma. Similarly, the qualities of a guru and the qualities of a Shishya will always remain the same. They can't, no, we are in 2020, you have to change it a bit. So we'll change some three qualifications, we'll eliminate, we'll restrict it to four, nothing. It will always remain the same.
Inviji, after knowing so much about a guru, the next dilemma is, for all those in this dilemma, are we to have only one guru?
Is there a dilemma on that? First of all, nevertheless, we'll take it. See, I'll put it in two broad verticals for a modern mind. One, this is a question which we need to address it to a modern mind and in a way which is appealing and effective. I'll attempt it. I'll make a humble attempt. See, let's go to the source of this question. Why at all this question? What do we do in our in our entire life. As a shishya or a student, we go for specialized learning from specialized people. A will teach chemistry, B will teach physics, C will teach drawing, D will teach music, E will teach cricket coaching. So our material learning has several compartments and has several specialists. So we are so well, our mind is so well trained to the philosophy that if you want to equip yourself in something which is not worldly, even in a non-material philosophical sense, when we are trained or exposed to so many multiple teachers, this should also have multiple teachers. That's one presumption we have. Somebody saying, you can try this, that is better than this. All these discussions do happen on a day-to-day basis. Hey, he may be better. Whom are we judging? We are judging gurus. This guru is better than that guru. This is modern mind. Now, all this is because we are trained and exposed to multiple disciplines of learning. But the answer to this question is, whether you want multiple gurus or you want one guru, the answer is simple. If you want solutions to the problems, if you want only people who will fix solutions to your problems, then you must keep trying multiple gurus. Whoever fixes you the problem, you can keep trying. On the other hand, if you want not your problems to be fixed, your problems needs to be fixed by a guru, but somebody who will take care of you. A mother takes care of her child for life. Can a mother be substituted by anybody else? Any other woman, can she become mother? Is it possible? Because a mother alone knows the child better than anybody else in this world. Likewise, if you feel I must remain safe, secured, and I am taken care of, I want my guru to take care of me, not my problems. I want my guru to take care of me. If you go for a holistic approach, you must go only for one guru. Because only a single guru can take control of your whole life. Otherwise, each one will be putting the clutch, one will be putting the accelerator, one will be putting the brake. You will be torn to pieces if you try your luck with multiple people. So your answer is dependent on what you want. And finally, I concluded with this. As far as Sanatana Dharma is concerned, this is not a big problem at all. Because every family has a Kuladevam, has a Kulaguru. Lineage of Prasaptars. So when you have a lineage of Prasaptars, do you have to ask this question? Similarly, there are gurus, like say Sadashiva Brahmendra, where families as lineage have him as their guru. So either it's one guru with lineage of Shishyas worshipping it, or lineage of gurus and lineage of Shishyas worshipping it. This is so common in our philosophy, in our dharma. And therefore, the confusion to have multiple gurus can certainly be addressed also from this damage.
It's my turn again. Many youngsters like me think in this internet age where everything is available for the grasp and on the touch of a button, we still need a guru.
So, you want to know whether internet can substitute a guru? Put it bluntly. How can it do it? I'll put a counter question to you. Suppose somebody wants to be a cricketer. Will he become a cricketer by watching cricket? By reading about cricket? Writing about cricket? Or thinking about or meditating about cricket, or going to the field, find a coach and start practicing and playing cricket. There is an answer to it. Even I'm asking this question in the internet days. I'm putting a counter question to you from an internet point of view, because internet is there. You can watch everything. Can it make you a cricketer without you playing cricket? It's not possible. It's just not possible. So when it is not possible for a simple game like cricket, if you assume, because we are flooded with information, I can simply download whatever I want, I will read it. The moment I read it, I'll become an emancipated soul. It's an illusion, absolute myth. It's simply unworkable to you, to, for that matter, anybody else. Now, it's like this. Jayastha Mahasanadana has said this episode. A Sishya goes and tells, I want initiation from you. So Acharya says, okay, go and bathe and come. So he bathes in the river, walks. Somebody unconsciously throws dirt on him. He slaps that servant maid and goes for initiation. Acharya says, you have to wait. After a while, he renews the request. It's go and have a bath and come and initiate. Second time, unconsciously, dirt is thrown on him. This time, he doesn't slap, but he scolds that lady for having made him unclean because he's going there for a pure initiation. Acharya says, wait. Third time, this repeats. He goes to the bath, and as he comes, it happens. This time, he smiles at her and says, thank you so much. I made mistakes twice. And this time I realized I should not have behaved the way I have behaved the first two times. And goes to the guru. And guru says, you are now fit for initiation. Now please tell me, can this happen through internet? And I'll put one last question to you, a counter question. Have we not seen in our own material education, teachers who contribute to teaching throughout their life, they remain in the universities, they remain as research scholars, they remain as doctors, they travel across the world to teach people, they remain in the portfolio as teachers. People who should be respected forever. Whoever is a teacher, whether the teacher of philosophy or an LKG teacher, we should worship and respect them. Because without teaching, nothing can be imparted. Right. We have seen all such teachers who are academically sound teachers. We also see students emerging from these universities and then emerging successful entrepreneurs, successful businessmen, successful managers, successful in every walk of life. And they visit the university and they are invited as guest faculties to speak. You hear the version of the teacher who is a classical teacher who can academically train you. And here the version of this professor, of this business magnate who teaches you what life means in business. Now tell me, a management professor and somebody who has been a manager giving a lecture, which will the student find finally absorbing? This is not in any way undermine academic teachers. Not at all. Without them, this student would not have become a manager. So please do not undermine it. Not at all. Not at all. So my humble view is internet cannot substitute ordinary education, internet cannot substitute gurus. And unless you are in the radius of your guru, you can be even 10,000 kilometers away from your guru, but you should be connected with your guru. And only with a guru, only a guru can initiate you and take you into the path of realization. Books or internet doesn't do that. And I've seen people saying, I attend this class in the morning, afternoon this class, evening this class, night this class. What's the use? Attending 10 classes doesn't take you anything. A guru will teach you only one lesson. For years, you will be meditating on it. And finally, whatever this course has taught you for several years, you might progress much faster. So what our philosophy says, Shravanam, Mananam, Nidityasa. When I hear from people saying they attend six classes, I always ask, where is the time for you to reflect? Where is the time for you to contemplate if you go on attending classes? So this is very important. So internets or books, one is gaining knowledge. One is gaining realization. You can gain knowledge through internet. You cannot gain realization through internet.
Feeling very humbled with your vast knowledge and the ability to convince the need for something. I'm extremely fortunate to have found my guru. But G, what about people who may not have found one yet?
Oh, you mean to say people who are without guru? Am I right? I didn't hear you properly. Oh, okay. See, this question is slightly surprising to me because in India and people who practice Sanatana Dharma, to say that they don't have a guru, it's a sad state. It's like saying I'm an orphan when you have actually a mother. Can you claim to be an orphan when you have a mother? But nevertheless, you don't have to panic. You just don't have to panic. See, there are two aspects to it. Actually, our scriptures say, a guru will find his shishyas. It's not shishya finding a guru. We are not that smart. We are not that capable. It is ultimately the guru who spots you, okay? So, okay, now you will, then our modern mind will ask, hey, guru will spot us, then we don't have to do anything. No, no, that's not the answer. When you do the work properly, when you work on the second vertical, which we talked as the first answer to the first question, starting from, say, God to realization, if you are passionate, if you are committed, if you are devoted, guru will knock your door and then flick you out and start giving you the initiation. Guru is that powerful. So have no worries. There are only two people. You are already, as a family, as a lineage from your childhood, you are trained to go to your guru. That's one way. Otherwise, if you have the thirst and the passion to God, guru will spot you. The third category is one who actually don't believe in you. So the answer is somebody who has faith and belief in God will not be without a guru. That's my answer. I hope I have addressed your question to the best of my ability.
Yes, yes.
NVG, now it's my turn to put forth two important questions to you. But before that, let us get into the public view that people have been seeing you in YouTube, and we've been getting extremely good responses. So we will take up a few questions from them before we move on. So with your permission, I will request our moderator, Vasumati ji, to kindly post these questions to you. We'll probably may not be able to take all the questions. We'll take about four questions from the chat box now.
Right. Thank you.
There are some very relevant and interesting questions here. And the first question is very relevant. You have to address this. How do we inculcate Guru Bhakti and teach Dharma in youngsters, especially when grandparents are not very religious but God-fearing? Another person has also asked this question but worded it differently. So I have combined both.
Yeah. I'll try to attempt the answer in my humble way. See, for young children, at least till they reach the teens, if parents practice Dharma, or if grandparents practice Dharma, not the parents, but grandparents have at least an excess, or they are able to connect with the grandchild, any one of them, if you practice your Dharma at home, for example, if you keep going to Shringeri regularly and your child is born to you and you take your child from the first year to Shringeri, after 20 years, do you think the child will say, I'm not interested in Shringeri? So we can't, the answer is very, 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 very critical in this way. The fault is not with the child. The fault is always with the parent. See, now this is the season. We have started August. See, August or July to February, we have at least 30 events in our daily calendar, in our yearly calendar. Are we doing all these functions as ordained by the scriptures at home? Are we involving our children to do that at home? Are we taking our children to the Guru? If you do these three things up to teenage, a child will blindly follow. But thereafter, there's a problem because the child gets exposed beyond teen with peer pressure. So it finds this practice not happening elsewhere. So it starts keep questioning you. And to the best of our ability, modern parents should equip themselves with some answers for some questions. We can't say everything, leave it to blind faith. No, no, that's what I have. My parents have done it, therefore I done it. He said, I don't want to believe it. Give me a reason. So somewhere we should now connect ourselves because they ask questions. We cannot avoid it. So this phase is that for, again, the burden is on the parent. Once this phase you cross beyond 20, if a child is trained, if you sow the seeds at this young age, at some point of time, it will germinate. And the simple answer is, you don't have to do anything. Take him to the Guru every time. And that is good enough. If you are not able to do any of these things, keep visiting your Guru as frequently as is possible.
There is another question here, but I think you have already addressed, so I'm not, I'm just reading it out for the other's benefit. How do we find a Sadguru? How do we identify and approach him? I think you have answered it.
The Guru will approach the Shishya. Don't worry about it. Be very, very, very confident that you do your duty. The Guru will command. I mean, Guru's care and Guru's love should experience to believe. He will lift you from wherever you are. You may be in the midst of millions. He can spot you. Don't worry about it.
The next question is interesting because it shows the mindset of the youngsters. Most youth want freedom to do everything. But when we say Guru, they imagine a person who will restrain their freedom and force obedience. How to change this?
They want to change the Guru or change the Shishya. See, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, if you read the lecture notes of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam and his Anugraha Bhashyams, he has always advocated Catholicity a lot. And Mahasannidhanam actually in practice does it to his Shishyas. See, one thing, you may have your rough edges. Nobody is perfect unless a realized soul, less than a realized soul, everybody is imperfect in some way. Please understand, nobody is perfect. It can't be. But you have your contradictions in your mind. You have your doubts in your mind. All this you are entitled to. But if you have faith in your Guru, that's one requirement. You should not doubt your Guru. You can doubt yourself. You can be confused. You can have multiple views, all that is in human, in modern world is possible. But trust your Guru. And go to your Guru constantly. And let us revisit the subject after a few years. A couple of years is enough. Please, I would like to know this person, boy or girl, who raised this question after 2 years, whether he or she is ready to raise the same question, whether he or she is stuck in the same position. No. You doubt everything in this world, but don't doubt a Guru. That's the simple answer for this question.
Taking up another question that is related to this, and you've almost given the answer to this too. Guru-Shishya relationship is defined as Shishya's utmost faith and obedience. How will one maintain this standard when difference of opinion is commonplace? How should a Shishya address this?
Simple. Acharya has said this in his lectures. you can neither have ahankara nor difference of opinion with your guru. See, with whom will you have difference of opinion? What does mean different? You will have one opinion and another person having another opinion. And therefore, there must be a common platform, a common ground to debate, to find out who is right and who is wrong. Guru can never be wrong. That's the first presumption. Because he is a realized soul. See, at that point of time, your impulse will indicate you are right. Because you will feel you are on the top of the world. Everything is under your foot. And therefore, Guru should listen to you. Guru's point of view may be wrong, you will say. But that's not how Guru Tattvam works. A realized soul knows everything good or bad. You will be wondering. There was one Sishya who wrote to us when we were writing about various episodes. One Sishya, she is a scientist. She was not, her last mile link on the scientific formula, she couldn't fix it. Acharya appeared in her dream and said, you do this. And she goes next day and she writes and then programs it and it aligns. What is that a guru does not know? A realized soul does not know. So the fundamental aspect is, when you go to a guru, you go with your doubts, with a firm belief, whatever guru says, you should follow. You can't be debating or fighting with your guru. Guru will say, all right, you appear to be knowing better than me, you follow whatever you want. He will wash off. Why should, see, what does he do? See, he doesn't benefit anything by doing good to you. Tell me a guru, you ask in 1200 years of our history, by doing good to a Sishya, what has the guru benefited here? Has the guru said, give me this? One guru in this lineage? No. Therefore, guru doesn't benefit. Please, that is the hidden answer. Between a manager and a boss, each one will have an agenda. And therefore, each one will talk from a position. Whereas a guru has no other agenda, welfare of his Sishya. Therefore, when he addresses your doubt, it may be painful to you. It may be unacceptable to you at that moment. Please follow it because it is for your good. That is how you have to take it.
This question brings the problem of an elderly person. How the others will view an elderly person if he pursues jnana. When we introspect, it is often said by modern mind as well as elderly that it is a self-centered attitude. What is the appropriate answer to counter such arguments?
I mean, approaching jnana is self-centered.
That's what the others view it as.
I understand. See, don't think you can abandon material life that easily and go to jnanaya. It's not that easy. It requires enormous grinding in material life. You should feel tired. You should feel exhausted. You should be blown out. You should feel restless. You should feel enough is enough with this world. Good riddance. That can possibly be the starting point of the spiritual journey. Okay? So you can't say these guys are all selfish or crooks. No. They would have done enough, whatever little they know. And if somebody starts it very early, he has earned this. He should have, in his earlier births, should have done something. See, without serving, without slogging, that's why we say in our format, you can't reach jnana unless you do bhakti, unless you do karma as a yoga. We'll speak about how to perform bhakti, our acharyas have explained point by point, inch by inch, how to perform bhakti, how to do namaskara. Acharyas have taught us. See, it's like a shamiana, where you fix poles here and there temporarily to hold the shamiana. When the man, after the event is over, the man starts winding up the tent. And once he removes the rope and allows the pole to fall, the pole will simply fall on its own gravity at the end. Will the pole decide, this is the right spot to fall, this is how I should fall? It doesn't. It simply falls flat. you see, Acharyal says, when you see a guru, when you see a Jivan Mukta, a Sishya has to fall flat that way. Then that is surrender. Because no inhibitions with your guru. You can have inhibitions with anybody, but not with your guru. Therefore, this will be the answer, I suppose, to your question.
I'll take this last question. It's a very beautiful question, especially for winding up. Can a person feel the grace?
Oh, no, winding up. Swami said he has two more questions.
Yes, that's right. No, the chat box. Can a person feel the grace of Guru even without seeing him?
Yeah. See, we have seen people, we have heard people saying, Acharya, Gurus have appeared in our dreams. See, it's like this. Both Kula Guru and Kula Devam, we would have heard it numerous times in our life before Acharya. People coming and saying, we don't know who our Kula Guru is, Kula Devam is. And Acharya will say, Tiruchendur Subramanya Swami, Venkata Chalapati, he will trace their lineage in no time and say, this has been your Kula Devam earlier. Therefore, go and worship it as your Kula Devam. How many times we have seen Sishyas coming up with this query and then Acharyas addressing them? You can also see Sishyas coming and saying, I had so much of tapam. I wanted to intensely know who my Kula Devam is. Such a deity appeared in my dream. And I wanted to offer this information at your lotus. Acharya, that's your dream. She has appeared in your dream to bless you. Go and have your Kula Devam. Have you not heard? So, see one thing. Guru is not a body. Guru is a tattva. As I said earlier, Atma takes a shape and form and teaches the Sishya that you are Atma and merges you with Brahman. So, Brahman exists everywhere. And Guru can go beyond his body frame. He has that ability because he is a Jivan Mukta. He can sit here and he can be part of the whole cosmos. He can see sky. He can see 1,000 meters below the sea. He can see anything. Because he is not confined to your body. And therefore answer is, if you have the tapam, if you are passionate, Guru can also come to you in dreams. And Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, in his biography, authored by Sri Umesh Ji, last paragraph, is exactly what Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam has said. People who still want to worship me only in this form, I am still available to them in the Adhishthana. He is not confined to Adhishthana. But that if somebody wants that Guru in that form only, I am still available for that Sishya's tapam in that form, in the Adhishthana. It's there, the last paragraph of a concluding paragraph of Multifaceted Jivan Mukta. So that's the answer.
It was very interesting and very informative. And I'm sure it would have addressed all their doubts, cleared their doubts. Thank you so much.
We'll offer all this to Acharya's lotus feet and nothing else.
Thank you, Vasumati ji, for posting the questions on chat box. Sir, I am intrigued. Can a guru wipe out the prarabdha karma completely and keep us happy always?
I thought I virtually crossed the hurdle. No. I want to be a little frank in this answer. Allow me to be a little frank. And this is more out of, I will say this answer is more out of my personal understanding and personal reasoning. So whether it is with flaw or flawless, it's all I leave it to the audience. The question is, can Guru liquidate our prarabdha? And so that somebody says, I go to a Guru, therefore I'm eternally happy. All my problems will get... He will eradicate it and give it as a clean slate. See, Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita very clearly says, even though I am the creator, because it's Brahman which manifests in as Ishvara, as Jiva, and as inanimate material objects, even the creator does not interfere with the course of nature. That's one aspect very, very clearly conveyed to us. So, when somebody undergoes, I'll give you an example, so that this example can help you to possibly understand. A very ardent devotee of the mutt, he had four sons, and the third son and the father, who was a Vedic Pandit, went and prayed to Acharya saying that all the four sons are married and they don't have children. Acharya said, the Prarabdha is too strong acting against all of you. The curse is too strong. But the family persisted. No, we have come to the Guru and therefore we need a remedy. Acharya said, all right, because you insist, I'll pray to Mata Sharada and give a rakshai to the third son who is physically here. So the son who is here, let his wife have this rakshai. She will conceive first. And after that, gradually the curse will go, and then the second son and the first son, it will go in that progression. So gave a rakshai. He conceived. And few days after that, somehow she lost the rakshai. And it became, the child got aborted. They went back again and said that he persisted, no, I want Guru to bless me with a rakshai. And this time he gave it as a mala rather than tying it, gave it as a mala and said, ask them to wear it, should be very careful about it. She conceived again. And unfortunately, for some reason or the other, on a particular occasion, she took it out and placed it, she removed it out of her neck for a few minutes. And then she wore it back. The child got aborted. So now the question is, has Acharya liquidated the Prarabdha? Answer is, Guru has blessed, and the blessing is actually working because on both occasions he conceived. But still, it didn't materialize as a child. On both occasions, it slipped. And Acharya cautioned at the first instance, Prarabdha is very, very strong. The curse is very, very strong. So, the family had an option. Look here, we went twice, they gave and it didn't work. Therefore, we will abandon the Guru. That's one option. I'm now trying to answer your question. Whether a Guru will liquidate Prarabdha. So the family had an option, we will abandon the Guru. Or the family had an option to go and surrender the Guru in spite of this mishap. That free will is always with that individual. And here comes the answer in philosophy, which is very, very, very important for any Shishya to understand. Whatever may be your Prarabdha, don't move away from your Guru. Because what can a Guru do to your Prarabdha? Acharya says that when you do meditate and surrender to me during your hard times, I transform. In the whole question answer, I want Shishyas to take this particular aspect very clearly in their mind. When your Prarabdha is going strong and if you surrender to your Guru, a Guru is capable of transforming your pain, your suffering into a tapas. He will make you a tapasvi. He will make you endure. Then see, now the answer is, has he liquidated your prarabdha? The answer is there. Out your pain, your suffering has become, has made you a tapasvi. What more do you want in life? He has transformed you out of your prarabdha. See, there are two options. You abandon your guru, then you suffer. You suffer your prarabdha and keep engaging yourself with fresh prarabdhas. On the other hand, you merge with your guru, undergo the prarabdha, then he transforms you into a tapasvi. Read the history of all the Mahapurushas. How they have handled their personal prarabdha and their personal crisis. They have used that as an opportunity and converted that into a strength. And I'll close with this story. There was a devotee died, and say he met God, and there was a conversation between the devotee and the God. And God said, look here, child, I've always walked with you throughout your life. Then the devotee says, how do you say so? Then the God shows the map and says, see the footprints. You see two pairs of footprints all the while. One is your footprint and another is mine. So I have walked with you side by side. Then the devotee points out, look at this face. This face, I see only one set of footprints. This was the face I underwent challenges in life. This was the face I underwent sufferings in my life. And therefore you have abandoned me because I see only one set of footprints. God smiled at the Sishya and said, my dear child, the footprints you see is not yours. It is mine. I have been carrying you in my heart and in my shoulders during this period of crisis. This is the impact you will get if you surrender when you are suffering. Therefore, answer is, whether he liquidates or not liquidates, you will transform into a tapasvi. And I say this out of give me the benefit that whatever I have shared is not from a textbook. It is not from internet material. You can trust me on this.
Sir, I wanted to ask you another question, but very truly said that the previous question instilled in me a sense of more confidence in our guru than what I had. And this typically is what you said, that it is not from a material, but you certainly see it from a lot of devotees who are sharing their experiences to all of us, mostly on a daily basis. So we are very glad. The other question that I wanted to ask you was on what is divine grace, a divine power, and a divine discourse of a guru, which you had aptly and very correctly, very elucidated in the previous question itself. So unless you have any other thing to add, I think we will take up one more question from the chat box, which was very important.
I will, because you raised about divine grace, I thought I should say this, because only then the talk possibly is complete.
Yeah.
See, in short, what is divine grace of a guru? Our philosophy says, see, all of us know the term sparsamani, the philosopher's stone. A philosopher's stone, whenever it touches an object, it will become gold. But remember, that gold article, when it touches a stone, it can't convert into gold. Similarly, a philosopher's stone, by touching something, cannot become another philosopher's stone. Whereas a guru is capable of making his Sishya himself as a guru. See, this meter of 36 acharyas and the 37th in line, I have to say this. It's like melting gold. If you melt gold, you will not get copper. You will get pure gold. And you remelt pure gold, you will get purified gold. You remelt the pure gold, you will get purified gold. See, this lineage is melting every guru melts himself and becomes his shishya, and the shishya melts, remains as a guru, melts and makes a shishya. So one sparsamani making another sparsamani is impossible, but a guru making his shishya a guru is the highest of transformation in human life. That is considered the richest and the highest. This is possible through divine grace and divine power.
Great, sir. Very overwhelmed by your talk. We are overwhelmed by your talk, and it would be appropriate on your part to give us the last few nectar of our Peetam for the purpose of the closing session. So may I request you to kindly conclude the session by some thoughts which you will want to give it to an youngster.
Swami, may I request, I shared one video yesterday in the group.
Yeah.
And the request. See, instead of me saying, because this might be heard even by devotees who may not belong to the mat. That's why I ensured that I talk only about Guru Tattvam in this evening. Dayanand Saraswati Swami has said something about our Peetam and our Acharyas. I think when it comes from a person of his stature who was respected all over the world for the immense service done to Sanatana Dharma, if that can be shown as part of if you are able to show that, I think let's have that piece of guidance as the closing remarks for this evening.
Yes, sure. We'll do that. I'll do that.
Relevant to others. And therefore, if we superficially look at the entire Vedic teaching, it may appear to be confusing. And also in some places contradictory also.
It's a very beautiful tradition. Therefore, Guru is not dispensable. He's not dispensable if you want to have jnanam. If you want to get confused, then you can read on your own. Desire to know is converted into desire to hear. And in order to hear the Shastra, he is ready to hear any command. Therefore, Kinkaraha, he becomes a student who can be called Kinkara. Kim kim na karoti di Kinkaraha. Enna seiya matan artha. What he will not do for the teacher's sake. That is the attitude. So this attitude is pakka, is a total surrender. Which is very understandable. And therefore, they have to be handled. Only a live teacher can handle. And a live teacher, how did he become a teacher? He had a teacher. How did he become a teacher? He had a teacher. How did he become a teacher? There was a teacher. Who is the original teacher? That is Ishvara himself. सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंतां वंदे गुरु परंपरा. Sringeri, गुरु means he is a संप्रदाय with. He knows this संप्रदाय. And therefore, listening to him is to exposing yourself to a pramana. And therefore, acharyas are people achinoti. Swayam acharati, anyan acharayati. He is called acharya. The one who teaches, the one who lives, and one who makes others live. He is called acharya. Sometimes the acharyas get stature because of their preetams. Sometimes the preetams get stature because of their acharyas. Sringeri has twofold stature. One is because of the acharya it has got a stature, and because of the stature, of course the acharya becomes important. Both ways. That's how I look upon Sringeri.
Thank you, sir.
What more can we say, yaar?
Very true. Very true.
It was such a learning experience to me, and please pardon my flaws, and request you to kindly take whatever little I could share and spare with all its corrections, and I offer this entire discussion of 1.5 hours of 90 minutes at the lotus feet of our Mahasannidhana and Sannidhana. Namaste. Thank you so much.
RKG, can you please, I request you to kindly do the vote of thanks.
Thank you. I think it was a session beyond.
RKG? I think there is some.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, RKG, please. RKG? I think he's experiencing some internet issues. May I now request Vasumathiji to propose the vote of thanks. Vasumathiji, kindly unmute yourself. Hello. Yes, Vasumathiji. Yeah.
This was a very enlightening session, I would say. We didn't realize that we were with you for nearly 1.5 hours because it was so interesting. And you addressed, Sri Venkatramanji, you addressed questions that all of us have in our minds. So many of us, we face these questions. And I'm sure it was fruitful to young parents, especially. And that was the primary aim, because we do need to address, and they are our future generation, and to propagate our Sanatana Dharma and carry it forward. We do need to clarify their doubts and take them in. So I would say it was extremely enlightening, and with the grace of Acharya, it went off very well. And at Tattva Loka, we are really honored to have hosted this series of Guru Saparia lectures. And this one also is another one of those lectures, as you all know. And I would say that we should have more such sessions where we can ask questions and get our clarifications, so that and it will be best done by a guru bhakta like you, because you have you're well acquainted with what our acharyas said. You've gone through all their books, you've done the guru parampara lectures, so that you're close to what they think, and you'll be reflecting what their thoughts would be. Since we have that advantage, Sri Venkatramanji was the most apt person to handle this session. Thank you so much, Sri Venkatramanji.
Namaste to all of you. Sadashiva Samarambha Shankaracharya Madhyama Masmat Acharya Pariyanta Vandi Guru Parampara. Namaste.